Hi, James.
Friend and men, today we have a great episode. We have the great Ben Johnson returning with us today. Hello, Ben.
Hey now, how's it going?
We also have one of my original English students of Turkey. We have my old friend, her name is AJ. AJ, hello.
Hi.
Hello. This guy is just, I can't say enough about Mr. Stanley. We have the great Richard Stanley coming us from months ago in France. Hello, Mr. Stanley, how are you?
Well, a pleasure being on the air, sir. I'm pretty fine. Just enjoying the beginning of spring here in the French Pyrenees.
I'm going to start the panel over, and my friend AJ, she watched four of your movies.
Oh my God, I'm sorry.
They were amazing, but I really liked, especially Color Out of Space with Nicolas Cage, of course. I very linked with the viruses from outer space. For example, I was wondering about the colors that I don't know yet, and you really visualize the color so much. Amazing. I love it. Also, my family love it. Your beautiful movie. I really wonder what inspired you so much to for this movie.
Well, I guess Color Out of Space is, the inspiration is twofold. One, I've been a fan of H.P. Lovecraft literally all of my life. And like a lot of other fans, I have wanted to see Lovecraft's work brought to screen in a satisfactory way. So one part of it was definitely a mission to try to translate some of the wilder aspects of Lovecraft's work to screen, and certainly the concept of colors that exist outside of the human spectrum that are invisible to us but could maybe be seen by animals or other creatures that have different sensory apparatus from ourselves was one thing which is very challenging to present on film that we really dived into. And along with that, Color also uses the soundtrack tries to push into forbidden areas of the sonic spectrum. It tries to use infrasound and ultrasound, which depending on the speaker system, so as to where you connect with the movie, certainly in the initial cinema run, it was having a very interesting effect on the audience.
You see the picture, you see all the details. It starts with hardware, and now Color of Space, it is beyond everything. It's different.
Merci, praise indeed. I mean, I hope that I've learned something over the course of the 30-odd years between hardware and Color Out of Space. And we've been trying to gradually refine what I've been doing. And I think the other element of inspiration in Color is very much the part of the world I've been living in. I've been living here in the Pyrenees in some very ancient woodland for quite a long time now. And the initial idea was to try to shoot Color Out of Space here in the Pyrenees, but in the end we shot it in Sintra, Portugal, standing in for Arkham, Massachusetts. But the essence of it is the same. It's to do with the wild woodland and the places where humanity hasn't had the chance to completely control the natural forces that are at work. And to some extent, the meteorite is, I think, maybe the ultimate expression of Lovecraft's conception of God. What the deity might be like, because a meteorite has this unique ability where it can create life. But if we believe in the panspermia theory, the notion that meteors can seed other planets with long-chained protein molecules or with viruses, it can literally create life but at the same time, it's equally capable of cauterizing all life on the planet and destroying worlds. This ability to both create and destroy life in other worlds, while at the same time, the meteor itself is not even conscious. It's not even aware that it's doing those things, I think says a lot about, yeah, how Lovecraft probably imagined the deity.
I love listening to you, Richard. I can listen to you all day. I mean, you're still so passionate about it. I can feel your passion for Lovecraft and his art.
But that's also like true Alpha Omega there, right? Like the whole notion of this unknowing sort of thing, a thing basically incapable of knowledge to hold all the power to it, right? Like it's
yeah, scary. I think he definitely saw them as a kind of a manifestation of the natural forces that are at work in our universe, because I find a lot of folk attempt to shoehorn Lovecraft into the matrix of good and evil or into some kind of normal morality. August Derleth, a lot of people tried to introduce the notion of a celestial conflict between good and evil and whether the old ones or the ancient ones were good or bad. But I think ultimately it's beyond all that. The meteor has no morality and is something which is probably unaware of our existence to begin with.
Truly, that's beautiful. And there is like a massive form of beauty in that overall that, you know, what is it? Specks of dust, right? Well, nothing. And I think that's a tremendous freeing sort of feeling overall.
Well, and like the deity, I imagine also beauty has no morality. The destruction of the universe will be every bit as beautiful as the creation of it.
Truly, that's sure. Beautiful. Yes.
But now, Richard, I just want to, okay, so on the topic of Color Out of Space, I was watching it today. One thing that I love about your style is you open it, and AJ can also attest to this, but you open it and it's so beautiful. It's relaxing. Nicolas Cage is relaxing. Everything is happening. You don't sense that evil is coming or the color is coming. And then when it comes, all hell breaks loose and Nicolas Cage turns into a complete... I just love how you transition from this happy-go-lucky family making jokes. I mean, it felt like a real family doing real things. And then when the color came, then everything just went to hell.
I have been looking all over for you.
And I just love how you did that.
Well, I figure, first of all, trying to make the Gardner family feel like a real family was, I think, the biggest challenge for me on the movie. Because, like a lot of folk, I'm much happier when I'm working with alpaca hydras and creatures and cosmic events. Trying to make a bunch of people who have only just met a few days previously feel like a family when they're sitting around the kitchen table, I think, is a huge challenge for any director.
What's this?
Cassoulet. Although apparently our daughter would rather have fast food.
And just what kind of meat do you think you're eating at the Golden Arches?
I know it's mechanically retrieved, but it tastes like heaven.
Just wait till you try the alpaca meat next year.
And particularly in the realm of international co-productions, it's super dangerous because the number of different haunted house and supernatural movies I've seen where the ghosts and the supernatural threat are beautifully presented, but the believability of the central ordinary family in the middle of it is open to doubt, because you've usually got people from multiple nationalities who've only met a few days previously. And to try to get all of them to feel like they're actually related.
Richard, it just blends so well. And it felt natural. And I'm going to let Ben. Ben's a new filmmaker directing his first feature movie.
Well, no. So the big thing for me is I have the benefit of working with Troma Entertainment. And earlier today, I watched an interview that you had done back, I think, like 2014 with Lloyd.
Yeah, regarding... I remember.
Very nice, very nice. About sort of financing in general. And then overall, I guess the interview sort of broke down to the notion of being open to what is there. So when we look at things like hardware, right? You'd said the script was more sort of heady to begin with. It was more of a story about characters and what's happening. It's a Christmas movie, right?
Yeah, I guess the hardware in its initial iteration was quite influenced by Soylent Green, Make Room, Make Room, the source novel for Soylent Green. I made a long Super 8 movie involving the same characters slouching around over Christmas and just not having a good time. Now, frankly, that would have been a very boring movie. After it was rejected umpteen times, I eventually submitted to Logic, and everyone said either throw an alien or a Terminator robot into the thing. So finally, we arrived at the notion that there had to be a monster.
That also becomes a thing for me too when we start to look at how to get a larger audience. I would assume I guess the purest artist makes art for themselves, but at the end of the day, to be a working artist, the second you get the check and you're able to pay these nonsensical bills, you know, your insurance is covered, you know, you got a meal to eat, you have all of these things, and your art is paid for it. Do you find that there are ever big concessions that you've had to make sort of at it as an artist, as an auteur? Really things that just in the back of your gut just knotted you up, any of those sort of concessions? Or do you just let the universe give and take and ride the wave, so to speak?
I think you've got no choice, but there's got to be a bit of give and take, because I think, as Woody Allen said, the truck arrives with fresh compromises every day.
This is what you want. This is what you get.
As you're aware, there's little trade-offs that you are forced to do on every single sequence and shot. Sometimes you gain a little, something's a little bit better than you thought, but 9 times out of 10, you're having to drop things that just don't work because of time, location, availability of cast, and you've got to be pretty flexible, because if you're insisting it absolutely has to look like the storyboard, you're often going to be in trouble. So there's the ability to improvise and make the most out of what's available, as opposed to a best case scenario, is really, I think, important to one's survival as a filmmaker. But in terms of maintaining any kind of integrity, there's usually got to be a couple of lines drawn in the sand, a couple of points where you really can't compromise on that. And you need to choose your battles very, very carefully. Otherwise, whoever you're working with will assume that you're a crazy prima donna. So
I sort of lived in that space for a hot minute. There was a particular shot, and I do apologize to anybody if this is too graphic. There's a thing that a lot of bachelor party attendants and people who've seen like Artie Lang's Beer League will be familiar with. It's basically known as a ping pong trick. South Park also made this very famous. Yeah. So at the end of the day, we're doing a massive bachelor party sequence, Richard, and I was like, well, we have to include this. It's a great gag. It's known by everybody. It's hysterical. People love it. It's their favorite thing. I extended the day by about an hour so that we could secure ping pong balls. But what I did was low-key, I told like 3 people, and I was like, this is what we're going to do because we have to have it. We're just going to make this part go a little longer that we're in right now. No, that one wasn't good. Let's reset it. Oh, can we get this over here? All specifically to get this one shot. And lo and behold, it's one of the best shots in the movie. It makes me so happy every time I look at it. But I've found myself playing these weird little sort of mind games, and it's not necessarily fibs, but like little white lies that you tell the crew, you tell the cast, and you're like, I don't know, we'll get there, don't worry, it's all in the setup. Constant struggle.
And it's usually, certainly with the further you go up the ladder, those struggles usually happen in pre-production. It's usually when the money comes in. Often that's manifests in terms of casting decisions. There's usually dissent over who they think will sell the movie best. And when you, hardware, for instance. I was so sold on Stacey Travis for Jill. I figured that the entire movie pretty much rested on the shoulders of the Jill character, who was there the entire way through. And I was dead keen on casting Stacey. Stacey had no real previous cinematic track record, had done some sitcom. And Miramax at that point were absolutely determined that she could not be the lead of the film. And basically, in order to hold on to Stacey, I gave up control over the male lead. I had to make a decision as to which one I was going to cast. Similar things happened on DustDevil and on the other ones, where when people are fully opposed to DustDevil, for instance, Miramax was strongly opposed to me casting the South African actors, Zakes Mackay and John Machakiza, because they literally couldn't understand their accents. In order for me to hang on to Zakes and John, I had to give up control over the female lead. So Chelsea became Harvey Weinstein's choice for the lead. The choice for the lead cop. So each time there's little trade-offs. On Color Out of Space, the line I wouldn't go beyond is that it had to be alpacas.
AJ, go ahead, ask a question about hardware.
It was a different perspective because I realized something in the movie, hardware. The robot doesn't have all five senses like human being. So nowadays, they, for example, Boston Dynamics, etc., through GPT from Elon Musk, improved their robots in a way that they can have five senses. So what do you think about it?
Well, I usually always take the most negative view, just because I make dramatic, often horror-orientated material, and I guess hardware took a very dark view of the future, which is probably why, sadly, it's still kind of relevant. certainly, the droid in hardware is malfunctioning, and it's a prototype design. I think that with a few little improvements, the human characters would have stood no chance whatsoever if that creature was weaponized. Which it's not in the movie. It's not carrying guns. It doesn't have microwave weapons, which is what DARPA are talking about for their drone soldiers. Technically, some of the drones that they're talking about now can literally see people through solid walls. So you've got the ability, not only motion detectors and heat sensors, but literally to be able to detect bunkers or to see it. It can see you even when you can't see it. It can literally see you through the wall, and with something like a microwave weapon, it can also fry you without even being in the same room. So certainly the a fully weaponized drone soldier cyborg would be a seriously formidable opponent, and certainly using a bunch of sensors and perceptions which are completely different from our human sensory apparatus, seeing things in terms of sound, motion, and heat rather than light. And to what extent the unfortunate droid is even aware of what life is or what humans are is open to question in hardware. I don't think, again, it's necessarily good or evil. It's simply following its programming and has a vastly different perception of consciousness from our own.
Horrible features.
This is what you want. This is what you get. This is what you want. This
Farah's here. Nice. Hello, Farah.
Hi, everybody. Hello from Istanbul. How are you doing?
Yes, potatoes are great.